Following program is an original production of WICC PBS Chicago.
Tonight, transformation. A Southside high school goes from violence to peace on campus in 4 years. Why this turnaround school is now at risk of slipping back into trouble.
What a difference 2 months makes. Mayor Emanuel's approval rate goes from dismal to better, but what's the real story behind those poll numbers?
Everything's bigger in Texas, a giant play to lure Illinois businesses to the Lone Star State, and why Governor Quinn is calling his Texas counterpart a big talker.
Think good manners are old school? Think again. Chicagoans get a lesson in the art of being polite.
And the firestorm over a local professor's scathing review of Chicago, why her opinion about the Windy City is causing such a fuss. These stories and more tonight on In the Loop. Good evening, I'm Barbara Pinto.
And I'm Chris Bury. Tonight we discover how one Chicago high school, known for brutal violence, has turned itself around. 4 years ago, the savage beating of an honors student seen around the world forced some soul-searching and some big changes.
Since that deadly attack in 2009, Christian Fenger Academy High School has adopted programs to resolve conflicts before they escalate to violence.
But now grant money for the program is drying up, and Fenger's principal is worried the school could slide back into trouble.
A student captured this horrifying scene on a cell phone for the world to see. The beating death of Darian Albert sparked national outrage. The 16-year-old caught in the middle of a fight between rival groups at Fenger High. The deadly attack took place near the Southside School, where violence had become a routine part of daily life.
Big fights in the hallways, riots, like mob action, police carrying people out every day.
There were constant gang fights, so much so at one point in time we had to have District 22 and District 5 come in and literally like help us like get the kids in the class because it was like out of control.
Under the guidance of Fenger principal Liz Dozier, the school and its 500 students have made a remarkable transformation. Fenger is no longer the violent, out-of-control place it was less than 4 years ago. Now the school has become a model for teaching how to resolve conflicts peacefully. Darian Albert's murder became a catalyst for some big changes.
The first thing was the gang issue. So we're not having this. If you want to come here in this building every day, we are going to have school. You're going to go to class.
School officials took a stand. They put a stop to such behavior as gang signs flashed in hallways. They got parents involved. They set higher expectations. And they introduced the peace circle. It's a way to resolve conflicts peacefully based on a concept called restorative justice.
Sort of justice looks at is how do we look at the harm that occurred and who is obligated to repair the harm to that person that was harmed.
Fenger Dean Robert Spicer directs the peace circles where students who get in fights must meet face to face and then talk through their conflicts. Key to their success is something called a talking piece.
This is one of the talking pieces that we use. And the talking piece is what we use as a way of allowing for our young people to actually speak and be heard.
Put things in circle that have to do with gangs, that have to do with like, you know, items being stolen, that have to do with just a variety of really serious issues. And the circle does help us navigate that.
To help keep the peace, Fenger also offers anger management, grief counseling, and trauma therapy. The signs of success are clear. Attendance is up. Fights are down, test scores are improving, and more students are graduating. One key to that success, more counseling. The typical Chicago public school has one counselor for every 300 students. Fenger has one for every 50 students.
It's like the school is very intimate. Like they really embrace the students and love the students and show that they care about the students. So
Fenger senior Veda Witherspoon admits she had a bad attitude when she started as a freshman, but after one of her teachers became a mentor, Veda has become a student leader.
I'm very confident in the things that I do and the things that I can accomplish, and I know that I can and I will, and that's what the school has helped me like as a person.
All that support and attention takes money. In 2009, Fenger received a four-year federal grant to help turn things around. But that money, nearly $2 million a year, runs out in July, and Fenger's principal is concerned.
We can go back to where we've come from very fast, because the reality is what's happening out in the community has not changed. The only thing that's changed is how we approach and how we deal with it with the kids. Here at Fenger, the solution is providing kids with what they need, and that requires funds. It just does.
And without funding, the school's principal tells us, those programs may not survive. Fenger High School is not alone in working hard to reduce violence. Similar efforts are underway at Harper High School in the West Englewood neighborhood. Last year, 29 current and recent Harper students were shot. 8 of them died. WBEZ's This American Life spent 5 months documenting life inside Harper High. Author and journalist Alex Kotlowitz was on that reporting team. He joins us tonight, and Alex, welcome.
Well, thanks.
Those conflict resolution skills that we just saw, are they as important to teach as English or math?
Absolutely. I mean, in fact, I would argue that you can't teach English and math if you don't sort of figure out a way to resolve the conflicts that inevitably spill into the school from the neighborhood. I mean, I think these kids come in with all these things bearing down on their shoulders, and the school sees it, and they saw it with Darian Albert. I mean, that Darian Albert was a dispute that they saw coming from within the school. It was before this principal Dozier got there.
So teaching these skills about resolving conflicts without using guns, literally, I assume, saves lives.
Yeah, it saves lives, and it allows these kids to focus on what's important, which, as you suggested, are their studies, which is why they're ultimately at school.
Alex, you're part of this reporting team for This American Life, spent 5 months at Harper High School documenting life there after 29 students had been shot, eight killed. Let's play a little segment of that.
Right. In the 5 months I spent at Harper, nearly every time I visited the school's social work office, which was often, Thomas, a junior, would be there too, during classes, passing periods, lunch, whenever. So much that one day I asked him, "Hey, every time I come here, you're here. Why do you hang out here so much?"
Nah, I ain't gonna give you no answer for that. Every time I come, you come in there for real.
No, every time I come, you're here.
Sometimes I just need to talk to somebody.
Alex, you spent a lot of time there in the social work office listening to students like Thomas. What struck you above all?
Well, I think precisely what Thomas says right there, which is, I just need someone to talk to. And it's what you see with at Fenger as well, is that sometimes all these kids need is an adult to listen to their grievances. So Thomas is this young man who's witnessed an enormous amount of violence. He was at a birthday party when he was 11 years old, and a girl was shot by a bullet that came through the window. This past June, he was on a porch with a fellow Harper High School student, a girl who was shot and killed, and he's seen a lot in between. And he's a kid who's just struggling. He doesn't know who to turn to. He feels incredibly alone. And more than anything, and he talks about it with this social worker, Anita Stewart, he's just incredibly angry.
And I assume that is a very commonplace emotion. I mean, if 29 kids have been shot, then virtually every student at that school has a pervasive threat of violence in their community.
Right. I mean, I think that what you see in these kids is the same kind of post-traumatic stress we've seen in veterans returning from combat. You know, kids who pull into themselves, just kind of wither away, kids who are depressed, kids like Thomas who are angry, who see the world as hostile. And we've got to figure out a way to confront it head on. It's one of the things I admire what they're doing at Fenger, which is they say very specifically they're dealing with the trauma with these kids. And if you're going to get a kid like Thomas to be able to focus on his English class or his math class, you've got to be able to deal with all these other forces bearing down on them.
We saw in the Fenger piece and also in your radio documentary, we saw educators and counselors who are really working hard, positive, doing a great job, but they only have these kids 6 or 7 hours a day.
Right. But it's 6 or 7 hours a day is not an insignificant amount of time. And I would argue that, you know, the schools are the one institution in many of these neighborhoods that still has some semblance of respect and dignity. And so let's let's build on that. Let's use that as a foundation. If we need to, let's keep them open in the afternoons and evenings. I think the crime is, and you so eloquently displayed it in this piece, is that funds are so short. I mean, at Harper, they have 1.5 social workers. They're about to lose one of those social workers, again, because of the funding that's running out at the end of this school year.
So schools like Harper and Fenger are about to lose money, which means they're going to lose counselors. And what concrete impact do you think that's going to have?
Well, I think ultimately what it's going to do, these schools at the moment are safe refuges for these kids, and I worry that that's no longer going to be the case. But more importantly, is given that schools are kind of the great equalizer in this country, it's the place where we can transcend our circumstance, that kids are going to be unable to focus, unable to learn.
And for the rest of us, a lot of attention goes to schools like Sandy Hook and Columbine, where there's mass killing. But these shootings come in dribs and drabs. It's almost like a slow-motion massacre.
Right. It is. And it's interesting, after Sandy Hook, I felt like we asked all the right questions. You know, we asked sort of what would bring this young man to this point where he would commit such a horrific act. What do we do about all these kids and families who have lost loved ones? What do we do about the community? What do we do to rebuild the school? We don't ask those same questions in communities like Englewood or Roseland. And we need to start asking those questions, because as you suggest, over time, the numbers not only amount to the same number of kids killed at Sandy Hook, they far exceed it.
Alex Kotlowitz, thank you very much. In today's society, manners seem to be a thing of the past, but one Chicago woman is on a mission to change that. Here's Barbara with more.
Thanks, Chris. This story is sure to make your mother proud. Etiquette Femme is a hidden jewel in the city of Chicago. The modern-day charm school, which caters to men, women, and children, is focused on taking the stuffiness out of etiquette.
The ultimate rule associated with etiquette is to treat those the way that you wish to be treated. And that's what we ultimately want to happen. There's even a specific way that we sit in the chair at the dinner table. So we're starting with our etiquette at this point. We always enter and rise on the left-hand side. So if we go to the left side of the chair, and everybody just enter in. Remember your posture, so everybody's sitting up straight. We rest our hands in our laps. And you notice how you didn't bump into anybody. Well, people have been looking for my business. They keep saying, I haven't seen this since I was little. So I think a lot of people have been introduced to it when they were younger, and it just has left them. And they're ready to bring their kids into that realm, and they haven't been able to find it. We're eating from the top to the bottom, so it makes sense that we have our soup bowl, our salad plate, and then at the bottom we have our entree. And then, of course, to the side, we have our bread, which you can utilize throughout the whole meal. On the farthest to the right, you'll have your soup spoon. And then next to that, you'll have your teaspoon. If you do an okay sign with your hand, and you put your fingers together, you'll notice that your left hand is a small lowercase b, and your right hand is a lowercase d. So therefore, your drink will be to your right, and your bread will be to your left. Etiquette is much more than just table manners. So the actual definition of etiquette is the polite behavior in society. So even as women, we have that nice, firm handshake, okay? You wanna have palm to palm. You don't wanna do this when you see a guy shaking your hand. You do a nice, firm handshake, but don't overcompensate by squeezing their hand. So now we're gonna practice sitting. I know you're like, I know how to sit, okay? But I'm gonna show you how a lady should sit, right? So we do this no-look approach as it relates to the chair. So we feel for the chair with the back of our legs, okay? So I don't have to say, okay, it's there. So I feel for the back of the chair and I control. I'm not gonna plop down, okay? So I control, so we have to use our quads. So you're gonna control coming down and you're gonna cross at the ankles. And notice how my hands were just right there in my lap.
Akilah has taught me how to stand correctly with grace and poise. And she also has taught me how to hold my hands, because normally I talk with my hands, so they tend to move profusely. So she's taught me how to remain with grace and poise.
Etiquette can be polite behavior, can be across the board, no matter what background you are, etc. People most often think about, oh, it's the snooty behavior. But no, it's just being respectful to everybody around you, being respectful to yourself. And it's not the little, just the table manners. It's more than that.
Now I'll try to be polite and respectful with our charming guests tonight. Joining us to dish on Chicago's trending stories, comedian and writer Patty Vasquez, Crane Chicago Business senior reporter Steve Daniels, And Chicago Sun-Times political reporter Natasha Karecki. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
We'll start, I guess, with a look at Mayor Rahm Emanuel. Now, this past week, the Tribune reported that the mayor took tens of thousands of dollars from hotel developers, campaign contributions. And these hotel developers need city approval to move forward with their projects. The mayor says he can do this and be objective, and he cited the new parking tax that some of these hotels disagreed with as proof that he can be objective. How convincing an argument is this? How big of a conflict of interest? Steve, we'll start with you.
Well, you know, let's be clear. Mayor Emanuel made some promises before he became elected that he was not going to be taking donations from lobbyists or contractors, city contractors. He didn't say he wasn't going to take donations from hotel developers that needed approval for city projects. So technically, he's holding true to his promises. As to whether this constitutes good government, I think that's very arguable. Is it kind of business as usual? Absolutely. Mayor Emanuel obviously made his case, said, hey, I've done things these guys don't like. At the end of the day, you know, this is the kind of thing that is troubling when it comes to financing elections, and obviously they require ever more money all the time. So.
Well, you made a good point. This is technically within the letter of the executive order that he issued not to take campaign contributions from certain individuals, but if these executive orders are so easy to get around, is this transparency just window dressing, Patty?
Well, I think it's transparent that he'll do whatever he wants. He says he wants to make changes that build trust, and I trust that he's going to shove policies down our throats. That's really what it comes down to. It's exciting that he makes executive orders that he knows what he can and can't get away with his transparency.
Natasha, your thoughts on this?
The bottom line is that, you know, we're known as a city, and we'll talk about that more later, as being corrupt and as having, you know, our politicians beholden to different interests. And if he wants to truly separate himself from that, he can't do it technically. He has to do it. Whether this executive order technically he didn't violate it, he needs to step back and make sure that he becomes completely transparent, or he's just going to become what we've all seen as a lot of other...
Another Chicago politician,
yes.
Now, I mean, is it a perception that needs to change here? I mean, clearly he's within the letter of the law, but if he's perceived as having a conflict of interest here, he needs to be mindful of that. Is that what you're saying?
Well, it's the letter of his law, right?
Sure.
So, it is a perception issue, and it is all about perception. And
actions.
It's a lot of money that he's hundreds of thousands of dollars. You know, let's take a step back and not be influenced by these interests.
I will say that in terms of what is reality, in terms of who finances elections, they're going to be business interests mainly, and they will have some interest of some kind, whether direct or indirect, in what the city of Chicago's government does. You can take this argument. I mean, this is clearly very much more direct than some, but you can take this argument, you know. Down the line to the point where, you know, in essence, businesses can't contribute. So where do you draw the line is really the issue here.
That's a good question. Now, in a recent poll done by Cranes, the mayor's approval rating is increasing ever so slightly. We'll take a look at some of those numbers. 21% of people say they approved of the job he's doing. 28% disapprove. A large majority of people are still undecided, but that's up considerably from February, where only 19% of people surveyed approved and 50% disapproved. Steve, what's going on here?
Well, that's a good question. It's interesting. What's going on is clearly a lot of people haven't made their mind up about the job that he's doing, which is a little baffling to me, because if there's anything that Mayor Emanuel is, it's, you know, he's pretty clear on what he's about, you know, either you like it or you don't like it. I do find that puzzling a little bit. In terms of what happened in February and what happened here, I mean, in February he was just coming off of the brutal teacher strike that was fresh in people's minds. It's a little less fresh in people's minds now. The murder issue, the violence issue was also really, really hot at that point. They've been able to point to better statistics since. Those sorts of things then result in, and I guess people moving from the disapproval category to the I don't know category, there aren't a lot of people who are saying, hey, I'm really happy about the job he's doing. So that's, you know, that's a potential problem for him.
Clearly lukewarm at best. Let's talk in a bigger sense about our city. New York Times Book Review ruffling feathers in a big way here. Rachel Steyer, who is a drama professor at DePaul, wrote a book review that some say was a hatchet job on the city of Chicago. She touched on every raw nerve we have, from the Cubs' losing streak, the weather, the murder rate, and the cost of parking. Here's an excerpt. She says, "And even as the catastrophes pile up, Chicago never ceases to boast about itself. The Magnificent Mile, fabulous architecture, the MacArthur Foundation. According to the Tribune, Chicago is America's hottest theater city. The mayor's office touts new taxi ordinances as huge improvements. The swagger has bugged me since I moved here from New York 13 years ago." Reading this, is civic pride a sin here?
Well, I don't think I've ever heard, you've got to see our MacArthur Foundation. I don't know who brags about that. But the fact that she said the minute she got here, she never liked it. I've met New Yorkers who said when they got here, this one woman told me she hated that we smile so much, that it made us look stupid.
Ouch.
That they were too nice. And maybe, I don't know if that's her problem with us. She's like somebody at a party where everyone else is having a good time, and she's like, this music's too loud. I don't know why everyone's so happy here. She's a wet noodle. I don't know. She's angry that everybody else likes it here, or that a lot of people do. I know the people who don't like it, who've lived here their entire lives and think that there's a lot wrong with the city. But that's part of what unites us, is that we know there are things wrong and we still have hope for our city.
Steve, your thoughts on this? I mean, full disclosure, I am a transplanted New Yorker, and I think this is the cleanest place that I've ever lived.
Yeah. I think that the thing with that book review, it was less of a book review than it was a smackdown of Chicago.
Exactly.
And clearly she doesn't like it here, and that's, you know, everyone's entitled to their opinion. The issue, I think, is I think few Chicagoans would disagree with the kinds of things she cited as being problems. Very few Chicagoans. And you know, the city is at a, yeah, not, I'm going to say crossroads because I think that's an overused cliche, but we're at a point where there's some real serious things that have to be dealt with that have been able to be brushed under the rug for a long time. I think that's all true, and most people would agree with that. I think where the problem was she was coming at this from just a point of distaste, if you will, for the city of Chicago. Yeah. If she had come at this from a point of, I like it here, I want this place to be better. It bothers me that we've got people boasting about certain things when there's these problems staring us in the face. Then it would have been received a little bit better. But it clearly the vibe of I just can't stand it here came through, and that was the problem.
Natasha, she asked, where are the female authors? You're one of them. You've just put out a book on the Blue Ivich trial that you covered. Do you think that had she been a native Chicagoan, this wouldn't have ruffled so many feathers?
Oh, yes. I think it's the reaction is go back to New York if you don't like it here.
Yeah. Don't let the door hit you on the way out.
Yeah. I will say that there's one thing that I think she sort of touched on but didn't get to very well, which is the whole acceptance of this whole political culture. And a frustration of mine and a lot of people who cover corruption and politics in Illinois is it's politics a sport here, but it's a spectator sport. People don't get out and vote. We can tell them, and we can write all kinds of stories exposing corruption, and the politician gets voted right back into office. In fact, their power might get more concentrated.
Welcome
after
to
that.
Chicago.
So it's exactly.
When we talk about, we have a lightning round, very short period of time left. We talk about leaving Chicago. Texas Governor Rick Perry here this week to try to poach businesses to Texas. He caught a lot of flack. A lot of governors do this. Why did Governor Perry catch such flack?
Well, I think it's unfortunate timing, too, that he has this ad that had, you know, run out the emergency exits from a burning building, and how government won't regulate as much and taxes will be down when you have this tragedy in West Texas. You know, yeah, there's something that wasn't regulated very well, and that a lot of people suffered as a result. So I just think it was bad timing.
Oh, the timing was awful. Terrible.
But he's not the first who's come in here, and Governor Scott Walker, a Republican from Wisconsin, came in here not too long ago to deliver a similar message. There's business owners are receptive to the, they're very frustrated. I mean, there's no question, but moving your business is a major undertaking, and there's a lot of good things about doing business here despite the dysfunctionality of government here.
Okay, we'll leave it at that. Patty Vasquez, Steve Daniels and Natasha Korecki, thank you for joining us. We appreciate your opinions and your time today.
Thank you.
It takes a special skill to get behind the wheel of a Zamboni. And if you're a hockey fan, you know we're not talking about a hot new car. We're talking about a kind of street sweeper on ice. Curious minds at WBEZ's Curious City want to know, how do you get to be a Zamboni driver?
Yeah, I want to drive the Zamboni. Yeah, I want to drive the Zamboni. Yes, I do.
A Zamboni is an ice resurfacing machine. It does four processes at once or one at a time. It shaves the ice or cuts the ice. There's a knife on there that actually cuts the ice. It picks up the shavings. It washes the ice behind the cutting blade, picks up the wash water, and then it puts fresh hot water down. Any kids that go to science class would, hot water has less air in it, so the least amount of air you put on the ice, the harder the ice is going to be, and also the hot water melts the surface and bonds it together better.
Yes, I do.
Yeah, I always wanted to do it. Working in a rink kind of paid for my hockey till I was older. It actually kept me playing hockey when my dad couldn't afford it, working in the rink, getting paid, and plus volunteering and free ice time and stuff actually made me a better hockey player. So, no license. A lot of rinks require a driver's license, but somebody wants to get started, there's always local rinks looking for drivers, and they train people. And that's what most guys that have done this have started community rinks and work their way up to the big buildings like this. Last night, once the housekeeping people leave at the cleaning, it's so quiet in here because the building fans are off, and it's like you could drop a nail at the other end of the building and hear it. It's so quiet in here. That's when I like working late at night like that. There's nobody here. It's nice and quiet.
To learn more about Curious City, log on to our website, wycc.org. Vote on the question that most interests you, then tune in to In the Loop. We'll put the story with the most votes on the air. Thanks for joining us. You are now In the Loop. The conversation continues on wycc.org. I'm Barbara Pinto.
And I'm Chris Bury. Until next time, good night.